being here today, being in your place. We want to welcome all those that are here as well as those that are watching online. We do have several announcements to make today, so some of these are rather important, so we want to take our time and just go through these as quick as we can, but we don't want to miss out on any of these things. First of all, the Baptist men. If you're someone who participates in the Baptist men or planning on starting to participate in the Baptist men, which meet the last Sunday of each month, we typically have breakfast served in the back. We meet at 8 o'clock, and that'll start again next Sunday morning. We have breakfast, we have a devotion, we have fellowship time. Now, with that said, if you're planning on coming or have or would like to come this Sunday, we just need to real quickly meet together at the end of the service. If you just come up here near the organ, won't take 2 minutes, won't take 1 minute. If we could just get together real quick, I'd appreciate that. Also, I sent out a text the other day about daily devotions, had several people respond back to me. If you would like to receive a daily devotion, they're not all my original thoughts. I'll typically add my thoughts to the end of them, but they're very good devotions that I've been receiving for quite some period of time, and I want to share those with anybody that would like to. If you would like to receive a daily devotion each day, either by text message, or I think I've got it set up now to where I can send an email also. I put two sign-up sheets on the narthex table there. If you'd put your name and your phone number, if you want a text, or your email address, if you want email, and I'll do my very best. Bear with me if I miss you a day trying to get those things set up, but I want to send those out to everybody that would be interested in that. Also, don't forget tonight, our evening service will be our quarterly business meeting. That'll be at 6 o'clock. We'll have our quarterly business meeting as well as the fellowship supper after that. We're looking forward to that. When you leave, the financial statements are on the narthex table, or the security guard back there will have those, or those that are watching security today, and they'll have those. If you take one per family, and you can have a copy of the financial report prior to tonight's meeting. Also, meals for Brother Lewis Carricker as well as Sister Valerie. I don't know if Sister Valerie's is finished out through the end of the year. If not, we need to finish it out. But also Brother Lewis's, I think the next 3 or 4 weeks are covered for Brother Lewis, Sister Cindy. If you'd like to sign up to take them a meal on Mondays, that is also on the narthex table. Don't forget the seniors. They'll be meeting this Saturday, October the 24th at 4:30. And having a meal. Meal's going to be provided there. They're going to have what they're calling a fall gathering. So today's the last day to sign up for that. That is also on the narthex table. So what you need to do is go out there and pretend like you're on a carousel and get your pen out and just start signing. Just start signing and get on board with everything that's going on back there. And so don't forget that. Also, annual training classes for the security team be November the 7th, 8:30 to 12:30. In prayer times, I want to say this before I say the last thing. I appreciate all those that have been so devoted to praying for our nation. We started a week ago?
October
4th. We started praying, trying to pray around the clock, and several people signed up for 30-minute segments, and I appreciate those that are doing that. I've been very faithful to my 30-minute segment, and then Thursday evening, I was sitting there about 7:30. My slot's 4:30 to 5 o'clock, and I've been very faithful to do that. But then Thursday, about 7 o'clock, I said, I missed my prayer time, and I didn't do it. And then I figured out why I missed my prayer time. I was voting. From 4:30 to 5, I was inside the Mooresville War Memorial voting. I said, well, I guess I was putting feet on my prayers that day. So I said, I have to tell Brother Dean I let him down as far as my praying, but I was in there putting feet on the prayers and actually voting. Yes, sir.
I don't know how many of you have heard me say what I was doing, but this has been a blessing for me just to pray from 6 to 6:30. I'm up to 2 miles a day now walking, and I'm walking and praying. I'm walking and praying at the same time, and it's just not even the fact that you're doing it for the election, but if that's something that you can just talk to God, just talk out loud.
Yep.
Nobody around you. I'd say passion on the road, they might think you're crazy, but that's okay. But if you're trying to get some exercise in, that's a great way to do it. And I praise God that he allowed me to do that.
Amen. Amen. And we do thank the Lord for that. Thank you for those that continue to do that. Want to say a special thank you, and then I've got a card here. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I want to tell you what it is. I want to say a special thank you, though, for the church for last week, for the gifts, the cards, the kind thoughts, the prayers, the meal, and I'll call them antics that went on in the back. We had a great time, and you do not know. I don't have words to put that in, how much we appreciate that, myself and Karen both, and what the church means to us and what that meant to us. So I just want to say thank you, and I truly mean that. Now, I have a card here that most of you that have been in the church for quite some period of time will know, and I'm going to put this in the back. I'll put all this in the back, but Brother Reverend Dan Abernathy was a pastor here at this church for, I don't know how many years, but a pastor here for several years. And anyway, he passed away on October the 5th. So Brother Dan Abernathy passed away on October the 5th, and they had a private service for him down in Albemarle at Kendall Baptist Church. Says you can watch the service on the Kendall Baptist Church Facebook page. But they also included, his wife sent us this, also included us a copy of the obituary and a card here. And I'll make sure all that gets onto the bulletin board in the back, because I know several of you here, like when I told Brother Glenn Henson, Brother Glenn said that Reverend Abernathy is the one baptized him. So I know many of you have ties to him, and so we want to make sure we get that put up in the back, and we'll do so. Amen? I know that was a lot to say this morning. All of it needed to be said, but we're going to move on into the service, and I hope you've been praying about the service. I'm praying God would move in and we'd have a great service. Amen? 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 Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. It's good to be here. Brother Dean.
Thank you. Please let
Amen. Good morning again. I'm glad I'm here today, even though it's been a little bit of a struggle today. And I don't know why, but it's just the way it is sometimes. And 5:45 this morning, as I was leaving to come to church, I even told Karen, I said, I just don't feel that I'm where I need to be going to church this morning. Don't feel like that I've got what I need. And so I've been struggling this morning and had some things happen along the way that helped me to decide on what to speak about this morning for a little while. And I've just been struggling. So we're praying, and that's just the devil fighting. The devil hates the Word of God. He hates the people of God. He hates the house of God. He hates God. Amen? And when we realize that the devil does hate that, hates us, and he's our enemy, maybe we'll approach him differently. But I've been thinking a lot about, now, on Wednesday nights, the last few weeks, couple weeks anyway, we've been addressing our country and the upcoming elections and what we're moving toward. Each week I've told them my goal is not to try to persuade them. You're grown adults. You know how to vote. You know what to vote. You vote as your heart dictates. We answer for our votes. But my goal is to make people more informed. So what I've done, and I will continue to do at least the next two Wednesday nights, and I don't know what subject this Wednesday night will be yet, but like the first Wednesday night 2 weeks ago, we talked about abortion. We talked about same-sex marriage. We read what the Republican platform was. We read what the Democrat platform was. And then we read God's platform. And we read what the Word of God has to say about those things. This past week, again, we read the Democrat platform, the Republican platform, and what God had to say about the Second Amendment and our right to bear arms and our right to protect ourselves. And yes, I do believe the Bible speaks about that. In fact, I spent an hour telling you what the Bible said about that Wednesday night. And so I don't know where we'll be this Wednesday night. But this morning, I said all that to say this. This morning, leading up to the service, I thought to myself, what do we need most of in our world today? I have watched the news. I watched the news. I guess I'm a news junkie. I love to watch the proceedings, such as with the Supreme Court justice there. I love to watch the confirmation hearings. I like the way everything works. I like the procedural part of it, and I enjoy watching that. However, I must confess, I told some Wednesday night that in watching that, even by myself in the room, maybe you're not as foolish as I am at times, but even by myself watching it in the room, I catch myself raising my voice. I'll catch my blood pressure going up. I'll catch myself yelling at the TV at some of what I consider to be just absolutely idiotic questions and statements that some make. Let's say that the lady that's up, Amy Coney Barrett, she held her cool a lot better than I would have. And so, but I love to watch that. I love the procedural part of it. I like to watch our government in action as our government was set up according to the Word of God. In the book of Isaiah, our three tiers of government was set up according to the Word of God. And so I enjoy all that. But at the end of the day, I think, what would make our country better? What would make our church better? What would make our homes better? What would make our lives better? And the answer is simple, I believe. And that's simply if we had greater love one for another. When you listen to some of the things that are said at the highest places of our government, when they look at one another, and some of the accusations that are made, and some of the statements that are made, these statements cannot be made in love. And what we need, even within our churches, is more love and compassion one for another. It'd help our church, it'd help our homes, it'd help our country if we could do those very things. And so when you speak about love, you automatically go to the 13th chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians, the great love chapter. And I'm going to try to speak out there. I've preached off these verses before, as probably every preacher has that's ever entered a pulpit. But I want to look just for a little while about love this morning. And I want you to think about this thought. You and I, we look the most like God when we love. We look the most like God when we love. We can prove that by the Word of God. When we are exhibiting love for our fellow man, for our enemies, for our friends, for our spouses, for our church, for our government, for those, when we are extending love and everything we do is motivated and marinated in love, then we look the most like God that we could possibly look. Because the Bible says God is love. Amen? That is God. God is love. And when you and I love like we should, and when our actions and our speech and everything we do is driven by a heart filled with love, then we look the most like God that we possibly could. And that does not go unnoticed. No more than when you speak or act or your actions are influenced by evil motives, by cruel motives. Those things go very well noticed. When we move out of a heart of compassion, that does not fail to be noticed either. People will take note. People will take note when you move that way. And so I want to look here at the 13th chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians, and we'll try not to be too lengthy. And I appreciate your attention just for a little while. Amen. We appreciate our visitors. We got several visitors here today. We appreciate you making the decision to come be part of our service. You could have went anywhere. You could have stayed at home. But I'm glad you chose to come here and be part of our service. And I hope God will give you what you need today. So thinking about God, thinking about love. And I was thinking about myself this morning. And how blessed that I truly am. And how blessed we are as a people. How blessed we are as a nation. Now, I like Brother Dean. Brother Dean inspired me. I told him this maybe last week, but Brother Dean inspired me, and I'm trying to spend my 30 minutes also walking. And walking and talking to God, and sometimes I'm driving, so I drive and talk to God. And like Brother Dean, I like to just talk out loud. And I'm sure if I go past an open garage door in my neighborhood as I'm walking, they probably think I'm crazy, but they probably thought that anyway, and I truthfully don't care. But I enjoy that time of talking and just talking to a holy God and thinking about how blessed that I truly am and we are as a nation. And during that time when I'm spending my time in prayer and I'm praying for God to move, I got to tell you, this is what I've been praying as of late. I've been praying for God to extend mercy to our nation. That God would withhold his judging hand and he would extend mercy to our nation. Our forefathers established our nation on the truths of the Word of God. And ever since then, we've done everything we could to push God out. We've pushed him out of our schools. We've pushed him out of our government. We've pushed him out of our courthouses. We've pushed God out of every place in our lives that we possibly could. And if it was up to many that are even sitting in our government today, they'd push him out of the church. That's where we're at as a nation. However, with all that said, God is merciful and God is great. And even with all that said, I don't want you to think that I'm down on our nation, because I truly believe we still live in the greatest nation on the face of the earth. We experience benefits and blessings that other people in this world could never dream of. And we take them for granted. But I pray for God to be merciful to us. God has so blessed us as a people, as a nation. He has blessed me as a pastor, as a husband, as a father, as a friend. He has blessed me in so many ways I cannot begin to tell you, or we'll be here all afternoon. One of those, or here in this chapter, I should say, the 13th chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians, we see many of those blessings. They're in the form of gifts. God gives each and every one gifts that are provided to us by the Holy Ghost of God, and he gives us those gifts that he could best use within us to place us into the body of Christ, where he could get the most honor and glory out of us. That's where things get turned upside down. You see, because in our pride and in our flesh and in our desires many times, we're looking for something that would bring the honor and glory to us, that would lift us up, that would make us look better, make us look bigger. You know, every kid when he's young, including myself, if you can throw a football and run with a football and play football, which I was never real good at, I was decent at basketball. I was never real good at football. But every kid that plays football wants to be the quarterback. Right? Want to be the quarterback because that's the guy that gets all the attention. He's the one that gets the big contract. He's the one that gets all the attention. But do you know how much good the quarterback would last or how long a quarterback would last in a football game if it wasn't for those, I can't say underpaid because all them sports people are overpaid, by the way. But underpaid in comparison to the contract of the quarterback, all those 350-pound linemen up there, if they weren't doing their jobs, he wouldn't make it two plays. But they go unnoticed. See, again, which I must admit right now, I'm boycotting football. I'm boycotting all sports right now. You watch them if you want to. I'm done with them for right now. Maybe one day God will change my mind, but I grew up loving football. I couldn't wait for football season. But again, like I said, watching the process in our government, I like to watch the plays within the plays in football. Many times I don't watch where the ball goes. I watch the blocking techniques. I watch how they open a hole up and how a lineman pulls from the left side and comes around the backside to block and to guard, making room for the quarterback for a throwing path or for the running back to go through. I like to watch the plays inside the play. That's just the way my mind works, and I enjoy those things. And those guys and those plays go unnoticed by 95% of the people. And I'm saying I'm better than anybody else. I'm just saying that's not what people watch it for. And so if they're not doing their part, the quarterback can't do his part. Why did you say all that? Because it's the same way in the house of God. When God gives you your talents and places you into the family of God, or into the body of Christ, I should say, and he's putting you there where he can get the most honor and glory out of you, you don't have to be the flashy head. You don't have to be the one in charge. It doesn't matter what parts you are. All parts are necessary for us to get to that goal. I'll promise you this in my body. There's not one part from my little finger to my little toe that I'm willing to give up. Amen? You say, well, what part's more important? Well, I'm not willing to give up any of them. My big toe is very important. In fact, that's where your balance comes from. That's how you're able to walk and to run, is because of the big toe. How many of us get up in the morning and say, well, I thank God for my big toe? We don't do that. It goes unnoticed. I don't do that either. So it goes unnoticed. But my point is that you may be part of this church. God has given you a talent. And don't tell me this. And my wife does this. And don't tell her I said this. But it drives me crazy when she says this. But don't tell her I said told on her. And she'll say, I don't know what talent God has given me. I don't know what he wants me to do. Listen. God give us all a talent, and my wife, which is sitting right here, is very, very compassionate towards other people. That is a great gift. That is a wonderful gift. The gift of helps is a wonderful gift where you're willing. You don't have to be the one to make the decision. You don't have to be the one out front, but you're the one that's willing to get in behind and push and push and push and help and do the dirty jobs that need to be done. Those are great. Everything I'm telling you is good and the truth. The problem is I've not got to my message yet. So hang on. So all this Paul is talking about with the Corinthian church, he's trying to get them to understand the gift. The Corinthian church had the same problem that most churches do, or most people do, and that's they wanted the flashy gifts. They wanted the gifts of signs. They wanted the gifts of tongues. They wanted things that made them seem to be more spiritual. That they were closer to God. That I'm closer to God than you. And God give me this and God give me that. That's got nothing to do with anything. God doles out gifts so they bring honor and glory to him. It's not about you. And it's not about me. It's about getting honor and glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. It's just like the song just said. We crown him with praise. If you came here today to receive praise, you're at the wrong place. Amen. We come here to give honor and glory and praise to the Lord Jesus Christ, because he died on Calvary's cross to save me from my wretched self and my sins, that heaven could be my home, that I'd be hell-proof and heaven-bound, that I've got a hope that lies beyond the grave. He did that for me. And because of that, I'm going to give him praise, honor, and glory. But everybody wants to be noticed. You say, well, that's easy for you to say. You're the pastor. I didn't ask to be a preacher. In fact, I'll be honest with you, I ran from this church for a year to be the pastor. I ran from God for close to 2 years when he was calling me to preach. I said, Lord, I don't want to do that. I was perfectly content doing the things in the church. I was in the church. I was working in the church. I was supporting my pastor. I was doing things behind the scenes, trying to help and push things forward. But then God said he wanted me to preach. And I said, nah, you don't want me, Lord. You don't want me because I've got a bad attitude sometimes. I've got a temper that's not good at sometimes. Lord, you don't want me. There's a lot of people be better at it than me. And that was a true statement. But for whatever reason, God chose me. I didn't choose him. I didn't choose to be a preacher. He chose me. I did choose him for my Savior, but he chose me. So with that said, that doesn't mean I'm any better than anyone here. It doesn't mean I'm any closer than anyone here to God. All it means is this is the job that God asked me to do for him. And if we were all preachers and we all were standing in pulpits and nobody was out there, we've done that. It's not a fun job when nobody's in the pews. It's a difficult thing. So everything is important. All that I said, I guess I could have said with those words, everything is important. So let's think about that for a moment. I'm going to skip part of this because I've said a lot of things I didn't mean to. The Corinthians again, verse chapters 12, chapter 13, and chapter 14. All these verses or chapters really need to be read together. You need to start at chapter 12, verse 1, and go through the end of chapter 14, because they all tie together, because they're all dealing with the same thing. In chapter number 12, Paul is talking to the church of Corinth about the spiritual gifts, about how they're given to us and why they're given to us and how they're beneficial to the whole body of Christ. He also talks about how the body of Christ is strengthened and how it's blessed when individuals use those gifts as God give them to them. Now, if you want to mess the service up this morning, and it would be more messed up on my end than the other end, so don't take this personally, Brother Dean. But if you want to mess the service up, me and Brother Dean just switch places. And let me go play that thing. There were 88 keys to be fighting back at me, and 3 pedals, I believe it is. They'd be fighting, let me play that, and let me pick the songs, and let me lead the choir, and see how that turns out. You wouldn't hang around to see how he done it in the pulpit, because I'd done run you off. But when we get where we're supposed to be, then everything works smoothly. We started in Sunday school this morning, right? So people come in. They come in hungry. They go to Sunday school. They learn a lesson there. They come out. They fellowship one with another. You come here. You hear the great songs of Zion sung. You hear Brother Dean and the choir lift up their voices unto the Lord Jesus Christ. And then you get to sit and listen to me spit, holler, and snort and preach to you the Word of God. When we all get in the right place, it works the right way. That's what Paul was telling them in chapter number 12. And then in chapter 14, he deals with the misuse of those signs. And he especially deals with tongues and healing. The misuse of those signs. In fact, if you read chapter number 14, what you're going to find out is that chapter 14 does not endorse, is not the word I'm looking for, but it does not magnify or it does not lift up the gifts of tongues and healings. In fact, if anything, it shuns you away. Away. And I'm not going to preach on tongues this morning. You know my thoughts on that. And maybe at a later date. But then right in the middle of chapter 12 and chapter number 14, in my Bible, I find chapter number 13. In chapter 13, in my Bible, the heading says, charity never fails. So right in the middle of those two, we find chapter number 13. But to fully understand 13, I think we're to back up to chapter 12 in the last verse. In verse number 31. The Bible said, but covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the privilege to be here today. Lord, I thank you for every home that is here and represented. I thank you, Lord, for our visitors that have come this way. I pray that you'd especially bless them. Lord, I just pray now that you would bless the reading of your word, Lord, that you'd give us the thoughts that you'd have us to say, that you'd help each and every one of us to examine our hearts this day. Lord, what we need in our homes, what we need in our church, what we need in our nation is simply more love. Lord, we need to let the love of God shine forth through our hearts and through our speech and through our actions and through the things that we do day by day. Lord, I pray that the world would be able to see the love of God in me, and that that love would come out so strong and so vibrant, and Lord, that you would just show forth through everything that we say and that we do, that people would see the need to turn to you as their Savior, that they could experience that wonderful love that you have shared with your children. Father, I thank you. I love you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. So the Bible said in verse 31 of chapter 12, but covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. What we're trying to say here, and we can say it this way, is that you should be looking for and desiring and coveting the best gifts. But even when you get all those gifts, I'm going to tell you about one that's even better than all of those gifts. That's what the Apostle Paul was saying. I'm going to tell you a gift and give you a gift that never fails, that will never let you down. And all the other gifts are encompassed in this gift. So you should desire the greatest gifts. I want the best of everything. That's in my makeup, and that's not always been a good part of my makeup. When I was young, if I was going to play softball, I wanted the best glove, the best bat, the best cleats, the best everything you could have. I could not just run down to Walmart, buy a $5 pair and say, oh, that'll get me by, I'm just playing for fun. You might have been playing for fun, I was playing to win. Amen? I'm being honest. I am competitive to my very core, I always have been. I can have fun, but it's a lot more fun to win. Amen? That's my makeup, good or bad. That's just the way it is. Now, I've mellowed out some since I've gotten a little older, and it's not so bad, but I always wanted the best. So if I wanted the best in the things that I was going to do out in the world, such as basketball and baseball and softball and volleyball, that I played all those things, played on leagues, enjoyed all of it, if I wanted the best things there to equip me to do the job, why would I not desire the very best gifts that God's willing to give me to do the job for Christ? To do the job for Christ. So I want to look at that. What matters the most? What matters the most? Well, it's not if you possess some flashy gift that you could show and tell somebody that so they would think you're a super Christian or super saint or this, that, and the other. And I've told you before, you should beware of people that seem to be super spiritual. You better beware of that crowd, amen? True people of God that love God and they're full of the Holy Ghost of God, they're humble, they're mild, they're meek. They're not out front looking to get attention to themselves. They're behind the scenes pushing God forward in everything they do. Amen? So it doesn't matter whether you possess those gifts. It doesn't matter how smart you are. It doesn't matter how wealthy or popular or famous you are. None of those things matter. What matters is how much love that you possess and how well that you love those around you. From your home, to your church, to your friends, to your nation, we need more love. So let's look at that real quick. Now, I've done cut myself down to about 15 minutes. I'm going to try to pack this in real quick. I want you to see, does the world see the love of God in us? That's the question I want us to answer at the end of this. Does the world, when I go out into the world, if I go to Walmart or I go to Lowe's or I go anywhere else and interact with people, does the love of God show forth in me that they see that? Me and Karen, this is last year. We rode leaves, looked at leaves Saturday up in the mountains, but we didn't stop anywhere, and we just simply rode. But last year, I guess it was, she likes to go down to Blowing Rock and go to those Tanger outlet stores there. She likes to do that, so I take her. I can care less about any of the stores. So I sit on the bench outside. She'll say, well, I feel rushed. Don't feel rushed, because I'm perfectly fine sitting on this bench outside. So I sit on the bench, and it never fails that there'll be another husband come by and sit down beside me. He's doing the exact same thing I am. And he's just waiting patiently on his lovely wife. And so when I'm sitting there last year, I remember sitting there. A man comes over. He sits down beside me. He says, "Is this seat taken?" "Absolutely not." I said, "Have a seat." We get started talking. We've probably been talking 2 minutes max. Find out we're both preachers. And we just talk and talk. You have that connection. The Bible says that our spirit bears witness one with another. We have that connection. And so I'm sitting there talking to him, and so I bring up things about God. And then he says, "Well, I pastor a church." I said, "Well, so do I." And we get to talking about that. We went down to, where's that island we just went to? With Clinton and Liz. That beach. I don't even remember the name of the beach we just went to. Folly Beach, thank you. Folly Beach. I'd much rather go to the mountains than the beach. Folly Beach. We went down there with my son, my daughter. So we're all waiting on a table to eat at a restaurant there. We're outside. I'm outside. I park the truck. I'm standing in the road. Man comes by. I started talking to him. He said, "I pastor the church right up here." I said, "Hey, so do I." We get to talking. Your spirit bears witness one with another. When you share the things of God, people will know you're a child of God, and your spirit will begin to bear witness one with another. And let me tell you this. There's a lot of good people still in this country. Don't you let the devil tell you that everybody out there is wicked to the core. There's a lot of good, God-fearing people in our country. If you are looking for them, you'll find them. So let me move on. Love. So does the world see the love in us? Let's look at verses 1 through 3, and we're going to see the greatness of love. Let's begin. How love differs from anything else, and greater than anything else we could have, we could be, or we could do. Love. Verse number 1. "Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal." So here we see that love is greater than words, than anything you could speak. Now, I don't consider myself a great orator, and I don't consider myself a great somebody to get up and give a speech. In fact, I've always been very shy about getting up in front of people and saying anything, and still don't enjoy that. I remember one time when I worked at a plant years and years ago, and I was probably in my, 20-some years old, upper 20s or maybe 30 or something, but they came to me one day and they said, "We want you, we're having a company-wide meeting." It's like 600 people worked here. "We're having a company-wide meeting. We would like you to get up and speak about this." I said, "I have no desire to get up in front of the crowd and speak to anybody." "Well, we picked you because we didn't think it'd bother you." I said, "I have no desire to do that." They said, "But you're a preacher." I said, "I misunderstood you. I didn't know you wanted me to get up and preach." They said, "We'll find somebody else." So I have no problem getting up to preach to a crowd of people. I've preached to large crowds. I've preached to small crowds. But that's different than just getting up and giving a speech. I'm not into that. And so they changed their mind. But love is greater than words. Look what the Bible says here. "Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity or love, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal." Now there's few things more ear-piercing than just the crashing of a cymbal and nothing else. If you take that cymbal and you put it into a band and you make it part of the percussion instruments and all the other, your woodwinds, your brass, and all the others, your stringed instruments, they're playing with it all blends together. But you just pull that cymbal out and say, "We're going to have a cymbal solo for the next 5 minutes. It's going to be ear-piercing. It's going to mean nothing. It's going to be miserable. And that's what your words are to other people if they're not marinated in God's love. They don't mean anything. They don't hear them. They don't care about them. Don't tell me how much you love me. Show me how much you love me." Amen? Amen. So love is greater than words. I got to move on. Verse 2, we see love is greater than the astronomical or amazing things. Look what it says. "And though I have the gift of prophecy and understanding all mysteries." Now, mysteries, we talk about that. That's not like the Scooby-Doo who did it. Mysteries are things that in the Old Testament that were not revealed until the New Testament. So understand all mysteries and all knowledge. "And though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains." Think about that. "And have not charity, I am nothing." Those are strong words. Your faith could be so great, you could say to that mountain, be plucked up here and into the sea, and it happened. And yet if you don't have charity, if you don't have love in your heart for your fellow mankind, then the Bible said here, I am nothing. I can get up here and preach the word of God to you Sunday after Sunday, but if I don't have a love in me for this church and the people of this church, I'm nothing. If it's not driven by love and everything I say driven by love and compassion for the people that I'm preaching to, then I am nothing. Same thing with our Sunday school teachers. Same thing with our choir leader. Same thing with our deacons. Same thing with everybody in this church. If what you're doing is not motivated by love, then you're nothing. Nothing. So it's greater than those amazing things. Look at verse 3. We see it's greater than self-sacrifice. Well, surely not. Bible said, and though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor. So you go home and you sell your home, you sell your cars, you take everything you've got and you give all that money and you go down to the soup kitchen, you buy food and you give it to everyone that's hungry. Well, surely that shows what a great person you are. Well, what does it say? To feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, or you're willing to be a martyr for the cause of Christ and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. You see, I started to say write a check to feed people, and I could, it'd just be a small check. But I could write a check for some amount and appear to be compassionate towards people that are hungry, and I could give them food, and I could give it to them, and they could eat. But if I'm not motivated by compassion and love for their well-being, the Bible said I'm nothing. And that's where we're at in this country. We have people that are willing to stroke a check, but their heart's not in it. Listen, it's much easier to write a check than it is to say, would you like gravy on your potatoes? And be part of that food line. And be part of the preparation of the food and part of the serving of the food. And help those people get out of that condition. It's much easier just to write a check and send it, a cold check, and never see them, don't care about them. Much easier to do that, isn't it? But the Bible said here that it's greater. Love is greater than self-sacrifice. So we see how great it is. I'm trying to move. We also see the attributes, and I'm going to move through these things quickly. The attributes of love in verses number 4 through verse number 12. I'm going to move through them very quickly as Paul gives us a very descriptive, specific description of what love is. So now, when I read these, and I'm going to give you just very quickly what they mean, then you apply those to your life. And you say, is that me? And can I say this? I came up wanting. It's not I don't have love for people, but I came up wanting in some of these areas. And if you're honest, you probably will too. I hope not. Verse 4. Charity suffereth long. That means it's patient. It endures under provocation. It means that it's long-tempered. It means you don't fly off the handle. I came up wanting. Second thing, the Bible said, and is kind. You cannot say the word kind without thinking about Sister Shirley. Because I love to aggravate Sister Shirley. If I ever quit, she would wonder why I was mad at her. But every time I do, she'll say, kindness, Rob, kindness. So kind refers to active goodness that goes towards the behalf of others. It means what you're doing is not for your benefit, it's for the benefit of someone else. Can I say that the value of your life is not in what you get, it's what you give away. It's what you do for others. So kindness. Moving on in verse 4. The next thing here, it says, and is kind, charity envieth not. That means you're not jealous. You're not jealous over the abilities, the successes, or the possessions of others. I can honestly say I absolutely love when people get new things. When somebody comes to this church and they've got a new vehicle, I am thrilled for them. I'm happy as I can be. If they get a better paying job, I'm happy as I can be. If they get a bigger house, I'm happy as I can be. I love to see people get stuff. That doesn't bother me at all. I'm not jealous of those things. That doesn't bother me. So I didn't come up wanting on this one because I don't envy what other people have because I'm so blessed myself. But jealousy is truly, truly an awful thing. In fact, jealousy was, it was Eve that was jealous of God that motivated her, pushed her to partake of the forbidden fruit. She wanted to be like God. It was jealousy that put Daniel in the lion's den. It was jealousy that put Joseph in the pit. Jealousy will drive you to do things you didn't think you would do. Jealousy. But when we have love, the Bible says here that love's not that way. Charity envieth not. It goes on to say here, vaunteth not. Charity vaunteth not itself. That means does not make a parade. That means it doesn't puff itself up. And it doesn't constantly try to put yourself out in front of everybody else. We all know people like that. That every conversation has to become about them. Vaunteth not itself. The next one it says is not puffed up or is not arrogant or proud. Moving on in verse number 5. Does not behave itself unseemingly, meaning it's never rude, but treats others with compassion and consideration. I came up wanting at times. Because I know I have been rude and short at times. And I don't mean to be. Sometimes I appear to be that way when I have no intention of being that way. My wife has told me that. She said, you're so direct sometimes you hurt people's feelings. I said, that's not my intention, but I am direct. Nobody ever walks away and says, I wonder where he stands. They always know, whether they like it or not, they know. And my intention is not to hurt people's feelings. My wife says I do sometimes. See, that's where she doesn't come up one, because she is compassionate and considerate when it comes to other people. I can tell you an example of that that just happened, but I won't. It just wouldn't be good to put out over the airwaves. Let's say it that way. So, does not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, means it's not selfish or self-centered, is not easily provoked, goes on to talk about that, means it keeps no record of evils done to it. Now, think about that. How many of us can pass that test? If we keep no records of evil done to us, or we're willing to endure those injuries that others give to us. How many people can remember what that man did to you back in 1932? 40, you say, I wasn't alive. Okay, 82. 92. The point is that if we truly have love and compassion and forgiveness one for another, we don't remember those things. There's not a person in here that hasn't been slighted or hurt by somebody. But we cannot let that be the driving force in what we do going forward. Love will make us look past that. Love will make us look past that. So it's not easily provoked. Last thing there in verse 5, it says, thinketh no evil. That means it doesn't take a worthless inventory. Two things I want to say right there. Number one, it doesn't attribute evil motives to people. We're all guilty of that. Oh, no, not me, preacher. Let me tell you how I know you are. Because we're all that way. The big thing, and I've said this before from this pulpit, the big thing nowadays is we text. All right? So you text somebody. And you go, how's your day? I hope you're doing well. Well, their phone's dead. Or they've gone out of town, left their phone. They don't have their phone, so they don't respond back. An hour goes by. Well, I sent them a text. They didn't respond. They must be mad. A day goes by. Well, they're really mad about something. I don't know what I did, but man, it must be bad because they won't even respond back to me by text. We automatically think the worst. But the Bible says here that love, not that way, doesn't think evil. But we do that. We look at things in a negative light. How much happier would we be if we looked at things in a positive light? How much better off would we be? The second thing there, it doesn't dwell on what others have done. So what I'm saying is it doesn't remember the suffering or injuries others have brought. It doesn't believe everything it hears about in others. It doesn't look for faults in others. When you look at somebody, look for the good things. There's plenty of bad in all of us. Plenty of bad. I just wrote my newsletter this morning. And I sent it off to be proof checked. And in that email, or in that newsletter, and I'm going to give you a hint on what it says there partially. I talked about how beautiful the world is that God created for us, especially this time of the year. But when you look and the ugly you find in this world, it's not what God created. It's what we placed in it. It's man and what we've created. That's the ugly in this world. So if we created it and we placed it there, then we can take that back. And it's love that will do that, church. It's love that'll make you look for the good in someone all the time instead of the bad. And I got to say that I try my best to practice that. When I meet somebody, I always assume that they're a good person and that they want what's best for me until they prove me wrong. I assume that up front. I don't assume they're there to create me harm or cause me trouble. I make the assumption they're good people. And we should all strive to do that. Let me move on. Verse 6. Rejoiceth not in iniquity. I mean, it doesn't rejoice in sin, whether it's your own sins or whether it's sins of others. Some people love it when other people fall into sin. They absolutely love it. They hear about, some churches love it when they hear another church split. Some pastors love it when they hear another pastor fail. Some people love it when they hear somebody else fell into sin. And now all the attention's on them. And they found somebody living worse than they are. So they put the attention that way. We shouldn't do that with love. I'm going to just read the next verses. This is love's strength in verse 7 through 12. I'm not going to comment for the sake of time. Just listen. These are the strengths of love. Love beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Charity never faileth. But where there be prophecies, they shall fail. Where there be tongues, they shall cease. Where there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. So we see all those strengths, beareth all things, believeth, hopeth, endureth, all those things. But then the Bible says that charity never faileth. So it never gives in, it never gives out, it never quits. The love of God, if it's in our hearts, and if we're saved by the grace of God, it is. Then when that love comes out, we should never give up on people. Never give up on somebody. Keep loving them, keep praying for them, and keep pushing them forward. Love never gives up. Last point. We see the greatness of love, the attributes of love, the strength of love there. But I want you to see the longevity in verse number 13. And now abideth faith, hope, charity. These three. But the greatest of these is charity. You see, if we go back to verse 7 and read it, the Bible said it beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. So we know that faith and hope are encompassed in love. They're all wrapped in love. And we will never, ever be more like God than when we show His love. God doesn't have faith. What's He got to put His faith in? What is God? Who has God got to put His faith in? We put our faith in God. Who has God got to put His faith in? God doesn't have faith. God doesn't have hope. What has God got to hope for? He creates everything. He moves everything. He makes everything happen. He has nothing to hope for. But yet when the Bible, when the Word of God looked to describe God, it did it in one word. God is love. And so if we want to be more like God, we simply need to let love show forward. Amen? So take the scriptures that I've read today, read them again, read chapter 12 prior and chapter 14 after, and read all those verses, and ask yourself this question. When I go out into the world tomorrow, does the world see the love of God in me? Let's pray. Father, I thank You for the privilege to be here today. I thank You for every home that is here and represented. Lord, I especially thank You for our visitors today. I pray that You'd bless them, keep them safe in their journeys. Lord, and I pray that You'd just bring them back if it be Your will. Now, Father, I thank You, Lord, for those that are here each and every week and support this church financially, prayerfully, and with their presence. Lord, help us to love more tomorrow than we love today. Help us to continue to let the love of God shine forth in our lives, that people, that this world would know that we have been in touch with the Holy God and that the love of God shines through us and that we do care, that we're compassionate and we do care and have feelings for them and their position. Lord, we thank You and we love You. In Christ's name, amen and amen. All right, I appreciate you being here today. I truly do, being in your place.